Good afternoon. My name is Max Schneider, and I'm a PhD student in statistics at the University of Washington in Seattle. And I'm interning this summer at the National Centers for Environmental Prediction in the Environmental Modeling Center. Today, I'm going to speak about data visualization, and specifically, how do we visualize the uncertainty in spatial forecasts? And I'm going to present some research that's in progress. This is collaborative work that's with my advisor at the UW, Dr. Peter Gutorp, as well as two collaborators, Nadine Fleischhut and Michelle McDowell at the Max Planck Institute for Human Development in Germany. So this work is all about spatial forecasts, and NOAA is in the business of spatial forecasting. In fact, they produce hundreds, if not thousands, of forecast maps every day. And these range from small-scale, local-scale forecasts of severe storms to daily weather maps for the national, at the national level, to global-level forecasts for temperature and precipitation, among other variables. So I'm going to focus on a few of these forecasts to get us warmed up. And the first is the hurricane track forecast. So here, the black dots indicate where a hurricane is forecasted to be at several time steps into the future. So 6 hours, 12 hours, 2 days, and so on. And this white zone around the black dots represents the spread in where the forecast model thinks that the hurricane should be at those future time points. So it indicates that there's this uncertainty around the location of where the hurricane is going. Now, many users use these hurricane forecast products every day. Among these are emergency managers at the national and state levels who use them for evacuation planning and preparations for shelters and other emergency needs, as well as the aviation community that uses them for air traffic control and rerouting, as well as airport closures. So there's lots of users, and they really rely on these forecast products. Another type of forecast product that NOAA produces are these spatial heat maps. So this is the forecasted air temperature 1 week from today, forecasted by the Global Forecast System. And the color at every location represents the forecasted temperature at that location. So we can see the spatial variability in what the air temperature is expected to be next week. But we see that there's no uncertainty represented here. And again, these kinds of maps are used by tons of different users. Among them are utilities companies that have to plan for potential outages or energy shortfalls, as well as policymakers at multiple levels who have to take into account changes in weather and climate as they make their policies. So the one thing that these forecast products have in common is they all come from models, and they all thus have uncertainty. We don't know exactly what the future will hold, and these forecasts all contain uncertainty. And we might think it's a good idea to omit that uncertainty from the forecast product entirely, because, well, we might think that users wouldn't understand that. It turns out this could be a bad idea for several reasons. So research has found that users form mental representations of the uncertainty in a map according to their own beliefs, according to whatever's in their own head, in the absence of uncertainty depicted on the forecast map. This echoes other research that's shown that in an experiment, respondents interpreted a deterministic forecast, one that doesn't show the uncertainty, as still being uncertain, just in their own way. And there's still a yet other reason why we want to show the uncertainty in our forecast products, and it's that showing it tends to improve the accuracy of decisions made using that forecast, while not slowing down that decision-making as well. So this is found in a review study of over 80 publications about decision making and uncertainty visualization. Okay, so let's say, you know, we want to show the uncertainty in our forecast model. So how should we do it? Well, the most straightforward way would be to do what these authors did. So they're showing future projected temperature change for the whole globe. And next to it, in an adjacent format, they've plotted the uncertainty map, so the uncertainty values for all of those forecasts at each point in space. And while this is the most straightforward way of depicting the uncertainty of the forecast, there's research that suggests that integrating information juxtaposed across those two maps is error-prone. In fact, subjects in experiments in this make more errors than subjects with different kinds of uncertainty visualization. And in fact, subjects perform better pattern identification and interpretation more accurately, more confidently, when they're shown the data certainty in a bivariate form. So rather than in two different maps, in the same map, but with two different visual variables. Okay, so we have some evidence that we should consider this bivariate form showing in the same map both the forecast and its uncertainty. Well, so how should we do that? So there's actually lots of possibilities. So let's look at the hurricane track forecast as an example again. So in this paper by Roginski et al., they show the cone of uncertainty in panel A, but another option here in panel C is to show multiple realizations from the same model. So this shows you a bit more of the spatial spread of where the hurricane track might actually go. If we think about that spatial heat map, like this projected temperature, we again have a multitude of approaches. So in this paper by Rechlis and Brewer, they actually looked at a dozen different approaches. Here are three of them. So we can show the certainty level of our forecast by sliding the color down to gray, to reducing the saturation of the color as we get lower certainty forecasts. We can show it also by overlaying patterns of either lines or dots that represent the certainty level of the forecast. So there's all these different approaches. In fact, there's a whole zoo of solutions to uncertainty visualizations just for spatial forecasts. Okay, so which one is the best one? What is it that we should do to effectively show the uncertainty in our forecasts? Well, it turns out that uncertainty visualization is not a one-size-fits-all problem. And in order to have an effective uncertainty visualization, UV, we really need to think carefully about the target of our forecasts. So in the research project that we're doing, we're looking specifically at earthquake forecasts. So earthquakes are just another kind of natural hazard. But one thing that makes earthquakes special is that after a big earthquake, subsequent earthquakes are more likely. So these aftershocks can happen. And even though we don't have methods that really work for earthquake prediction, we do have good means of aftershock forecasting. And in fact, the USGS has released automated aftershock forecasting for aftershocks in seismically active areas. And this is really important because we know that aftershocks destabilize buildings and make a bad situation already worse. And so good forecasts and good forecast representation can really help reduce the seismic risk in seismically active areas. So in order to get at what would be effective UV for aftershock forecasts, I spoke to four emergency managers in the Pacific Northwest. And I asked them how they use hazard forecasts and how they could use these new aftershock forecasts. And well, one thing that came out of these interviews is that they actually really care about the uncertainty in their forecasts. So even though you might think that it just complicates matters to show the uncertainty, The emergency managers repeated that in each of their own ways, they want to get that information. And they also indicated, when I kind of boiled down these interviews, that there's two really important use cases for aftershock forecasts and the visualizations thereof. So the first is situational awareness. The emergency managers want to guide how the crews that they're responsible for are aware of future hazard. And the second is resource allocation in a limited resource environment. So how can we send search and rescue teams? How can we distribute building inspection teams across an area while keeping them safe from potential aftershocks? So I boiled this down into two communication goals that an aftershock uncertainty visualization should have. So if the UV is successful, then it tells the user where an aftershock is likely and where it is unlikely. And secondly, a UV should tell us where the potential risk is great. So where even if the aftershock forecast is low, the certainty level is so low that a bad surprise is possible. And in fact, we could have a lot of aftershocks there. So I'm going to test four different UVs against each other. And to do this, we've developed a human subjects experiment. Well, not that kind of human subjects experiment. We're doing an online study of folks in the US West Coast to ask them to perform several tasks with a given UV. And so I'm gonna introduce now the UVs. So this is our forecast map. In our situation, an earthquake has just happened, and the aftershock forecast says that there should be 60 aftershocks in that region. And this is a map of that forecast where the color of the grid cell tells you how many aftershocks are expected in that grid cell, in that area, in the next week. So the darker the color, the more aftershocks we would expect in the next week. And I should say now that these are really stripped down visualizations. So we've removed all of the roads, natural features, topography that you would see in a forecast product in order to really tease out the effect of the visual elements within the visualization that lead to improved task performance. So we don't want to see effects of all these external, extraneous pieces of the forecast visualization product. We just want to see the effect of the visualization components that we're changing. So as I said, every forecast comes with error. And this visualization now has the forecast map adjacent with its uncertainty map. And so in the uncertainty map, the darker the color, the higher, so now it's a certainty map actually, the higher the certainty level is of the forecast. So areas that have a really dark color, we're much more sure that the forecast should be accurate in the next week. Now we can overlay those two maps together in this bivariate approach, and typically the visualization literature really supports the using transparency of the color as a way of showing the certainty level of the forecast. So we're testing that. And we're also testing a kind of statistical approach to this UV problem. So why not show kind of a confidence band of the forecast? So on the left side, we have the lowest end of the spectrum of the forecast distribution. And on the right side, we have kind of the highest aftershock rate that is reasonably likely given the forecast model. And so this approach is actually being used by a number of government agencies, this kind of upper and lower bound maps of the forecast distribution. So we wanted to test that as well. And so we're testing each one of these three UVs against the forecast depicted without its uncertainty, because this is what the USGS and other agencies are currently showing aftershock forecasts as, just the forecast, no uncertainty. And what we want to get at is UV effectiveness. So what does it mean for a UV to actually be effective? So in our experiment, a UV is effective if it can be read both quickly and accurately, if people understand what they read, and if reading the map doesn't take very long, and if the UV facilitates predictions about the future that incorporate the uncertainty given in the map. So if the predictions that a user makes about next week's aftershock rate actually uses the uncertainty that was represented on the map. And so we're using several tasks in our experiment to pick out these two measures of UV effectiveness. We have two map reading tasks where users are asked to give the forecast and certainty levels for a particular marked location on the map, and another task where they have to click on a particular location that meets a particular certainty and forecast level. This is just to see if they can read the map in the first place. Secondly, we're asking users to do several prediction tasks. So one is a comparative task where they have to compare which, between two marked areas, which they predict will have more aftershocks. And finally, there's a spatial prediction task where they have to select a zone on the forecast map where they predict most of the aftershocks will take place. So there's 60 in the total map, but which smaller sub-region do they expect most to take place? And they're incentivized in this task to give a region that's as small as possible, but as big as necessary. So we piloted this study a few months ago, and we're excited to launch the main experiment later this year and to share the results of this with the whole community. So what did we learn today? Well, let's go back to this air temperature prediction from NOAA's GFS. So I argue that this is not the most effective way to display this forecast, and it's because users are left to fill in the blanks on where the forecast is more or less certain. And research shows that that's exactly what they'll do in the absence of an uncertainty visualization. So if NOAA's mission is really to guide users' decision-making with their forecast products, then they need to show their forecasts together with their uncertainty. And there's many, many ways of doing this. So I urge NOAA scientists to use UVs that have been empirically validated and that are appropriate for their specific use case. I also encourage NOAA researchers to do their own validation experiments on UVs and other visualizations. The only way we'll know if a visualization was effective or not is by targeting a very specific set of communication goals and being very careful about what it means to be effective in that case. So the benefits of this could be really huge. At the end of the day, the goal of all science agencies is to improve their users' decision-making and predictions about the future using their forecast products. For a forecast product to be of use, it must be read quickly and accurately, and it must facilitate good predictions and good decision-making in the future. And I think that an effective UV can accomplish this, and I look forward to seeing their use spread across NOAA and its forecast products. So with that, I thank you, and I'm looking forward to your questions in the Q&A.